If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this episode of Mind Pump, for the first 26 minutes, we have some fun conversation before we get into the questions. We talk about Adam's super expensive Whole Foods cashews.
So unnecessary.
Yeah, calling me out because of our sponsor.
Yeah, you actually, it was like 16 ounces, like $15 for cashews, where I got mine at Thrive Market.
He just has money to throw away.
Under $10, same thing. Again, Thrive Market, organic, non-GMO foods, online for the same price or even cheaper than their conventional counterparts. Mind Pump has hooked you up. Go to thrivemarket.com/mindpump and you'll get $20 off the first three orders of $49 or more, free shipping, and a free month membership. We also talk about my need to save money because of the cost of private school.
Yeah.
Breaking the bank. I'll be driving the Jetta
forever.
Gotta
be thrifty, man.
We talk about the difference between public and private schools. We talk about high school reunions. I refuse to go to mine.
Lame.
And the lawsuits against...
Unpopular.
He's got no friends.
The lawsuit. You guys are my friends, right? And the lawsuits against the soda companies. Apparently, people are saying that diet sodas...
Made you fat.
...are making them fat, and they're suing them. This is crazy.
What do we think about that?
This is crazy.
I did a post on my IG.
Diet Coke made me fat.
We also mentioned our sponsor, Organifi. If you go to OrganifiShop.com, enter the code MINDPUMP, you'll get a big discount. Then we get into the questions. The first question was, what kind of hobbies do we have outside of fitness and optimization?
Again, Sal has no life.
And do we think it impacts
us? I wear a clown suit.
And our abilities and perspectives. You do what?
I have no friends.
You're so weird.
You didn't know that about me?
The next question was, do we have a go-to routine to bounce back after a night of drinking? Justin lays down the wisdom in that question.
Oh, yeah.
He's very experienced.
I navigate.
Then we talk about the benefit of having, what is the difference between having someone spot you and giving you a forced rep versus you stopping short on your own? Which one is
better? That's right. Does your workout partner suck? Yeah.
Fire your gym buddy.
Exactly. And the final question, in episode 610, one of our guests, Dr. Andy Galpin, a great guy, very smart dude, talks about how Orange Theory took an old proven wrong concept of optimal training with their heart rate zone. He actually got it wrong. It's EPOC is what they talk about. We dispel it a little bit and we talk about Orange Theory and we talk about, and Adam talks about his experiences at Orange Theory. Also, I'd like to remind everybody that we offer something called a MAPS Super Bundle. And I want to say that because we have a lot of new listeners coming on the show. I've been on a few podcasts, and the boys have also been on some of the podcasts, so we might have some new listeners. Here's what this MAP Super Bundle is. We took all of our best programs, we put them together so that people can enroll in something and have a year's worth of detailed exercise programming. In other words, if you enroll in the MAP Super Bundle, you'll have your year planned out for you. You'll know what to do when. It's different phases, different adaptations. You'll go from training for strength to training for athletic performance, to training for aesthetics, to body weight training. There's correctional exercises in there, video demos, it's blueprints, it's our explanations, breaking it down. It's like having us as your coach. It's almost as good as having us as your coach, but it's all in this super bundle. It's a year's worth of exercise programming. We're probably the only fitness podcast on earth that's going to tell you it's going to take longer than 30 days to get your ideal shape, and you can find it at mindpumpmedia.com.
T-shirt time.
Give away some shirts, Doug. How many reviews did we do?
18.
Hey.
Right, not bad.
Legal.
I like it. Yeah, finally legal.
All right. We're giving out 5 shirts, starting with Chris 18, Gussie Gussie, Charisse Brady 7, Danny Rhea, Painter Raider. All of you are winners. Send the name I just read to iTunes at mindpumpmedia.com. Send your shirt size, your shipping address, and we'll get that right out to you.
Thanks, guys and girls. Also, if you want to leave a review and win a t-shirt because your odds are super high, just go to your podcast app, click on it. You got to search the name Mind Pump, even if you subscribe.
Like you have never met us.
Click on an icon. When it comes up, there'll be a little section that says reviews. Leave a 5-star review. Leave a great review. If we like it, You'll get a free t-shirt, and these shirts are worth a lot of money. Yeah. How about the Kansas City podcast making fun of my voice?
Oh my God, dude, I love them for that intro. That was so funny. I was dying.
You know what's you know what it is? We're so hospitable. They're like, oh, we're friends now. Yeah. We're not that close.
Now we're going to fuck with you.
We're not that close.
Yeah.
You can't make fun of me. Like
the Maps Doritos were pretty awesome. Or pizza rolls.
Yeah, that was a good
pizza,
one. Yeah.
Naps and pizza rolls.
They're good guys.
Good guys.
Dude, why are you getting cashews from Whole Foods, bro?
Why are you going to bust me out like
You know
that?
What it is? You know what it is?
You know we have a sponsor, right?
I was already there. I paid the extra money. I fucking
bro, what'd you pay? Like 15 bucks. That's like $15, right?
Yeah, no, it's
the one I get from Thrive is under $10.
No wonder you're poor, dude.
Dude, let me he's not because he doesn't have kids.
That's
why he's rich.
That's why he just like spends on whatever.
Dude, so talk about saving money because, and thank you, Thrive Market, for saving a shit ton of money for these purchases because I'm going to need it, dude. This weekend, I went and did these open houses at some of these private high schools around here.
Yeah.
I don't want to name what they are because, you know, I don't like to put, you know, where my kids go and all that stuff, but they're in the, you know, in the area. I'm looking at these private schools. First of all, you guys went to public school, right?
Yep.
So did I. And I'm going to straight up, the public school system in California generally is shit. So it generally sucks.
Totally offended okay. all our teachers. Yeah,
that's okay.
Certain areas that are better than others.
Part of the reason why it sucks is not because of the teachers. It's really not the teachers' fault in many, many cases. I think we don't need to get into that, but I do think that, you know, teachers that do really well don't even get compensated for it, and then there's problems with getting rid of bad ones, and that's part of it. But nonetheless, it's just bad, especially for, like, if you buy a house in San Jose, in the worst part of San Jose, you're going to spend like $750,000. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And then you have a public school that you got to send your kids to that is horrible on top of it. So it's just obviously things are super expensive here. But these high schools, dude, the difference between
private elementary and then private high school?
Oh, no. I forget the price because it is expensive on top of, you know, paying my taxes for public school I'm not going to use. Then I have to pay extra for the school that I'm going to send my kids to. But it's a different world. Like, I remember my high school that I went to, and it wasn't necessarily a bad high school, but the difference in the quality of these high school campuses are like college, dude. It's like you're walking on a college campus. I'm going in the science department or whatever, and it's like laboratories. Like, I don't remember any of this stuff in school. I'm going to the robotics. One of these high schools, they're like the reigning champions of the world for robotics. I go in the robotics lab or whatever, and I'm like, I feel like I'm in like Tesla. You know what I mean? With these kids working on these robots, and there's like 3D printers, and the teachers are like super, like, you know, in there, and there's kids touring everybody wearing shirt and ties, and, you know, the guys are wearing shirt and ties, and the girls are all professional, and the way they're talking, and I'm just like, holy shit, like, it's another world, dude. It's a whole nother world. I couldn't imagine being in that world growing up and, you know, where I may have been or what would have happened.
Oh, I always wonder that same thing, too. This is an ongoing debate between... the irony is Katrina and I don't have kids, and it's an ongoing debate that we have all the time because she grew up in public school, and so did her siblings, but... you know, my mom, my best friend, they're in teaching, and
half my family's teachers.
Yeah, you know, so I have a ton of teachers and principals and vice principals and stuff like that in my family. And anyone that's in the system is like, if you can afford to put your kids in private school, put your kids in private school. And that's them saying that working in public schools, you know, and they know it's not. You can't compare. You don't get the same type of attention. There's less control in it. It's it's not to say that you can't.
But it breaks the bank, dude.
Yeah.
Especially around here, because, you know, in Silicon Valley, everything is crazy. Mm-hmm. Like, everything is super expensive. So no matter, because there's so much competition.
Well, it's even like college, right? It's the high schools over here for private are like
$20,000 a year.
Yeah.
Yeah, you'll be spending, if you count books and everything, close to $100,000 for 4 years of high school.
That's crazy, dude.
But and you're right, it is crazy. But when you, like, I've taken, because I've done open houses at the public schools, because I'm like, okay, let's, you know, the high schools and stuff. There's no, it's like a totally different world. It's completely different. Like, just the resources that they have and the, you know, the everything. Like, at one of the high schools I was going, I went to, they have the science department that works with NASA. You know what I'm saying?
Cool.
So like if you have a kid that is like a high performing kid and you're really involved or whatever, like let's go
get Buzz Aldrin in the mix here.
It creates like crazy opportunities. Nonetheless, I'm going to have to start saving. I'll be driving the Jetta for a while.
Mind pump
can blow up and I'll be driving my Jetta, dude, because it breaks the bank.
I'm like, son, you got to use the internet. That's my,
I told my kid, it's either like, hey, I either pay for high school or college. Take your pick, because I can't do both, dude.
Well, then you see some of these parents that would be popping out 3, 4, 5 kids and be thinking to yourself, God damn, dude, that's like.
Dude, don't get me started with that.
Yeah, well, some of the private schools, what is it, Harker?
Yeah.
You know how much Harker costs?
Dude, Harker's insane.
Harker elementary school is, the elementary school, $40,000 a year.
Yeah.
For the elementary school. See, like, your kid's in first grade, bro.
Yeah, I had a client who's...
like, what are you teaching my kid in first grade worth $40,000,
dude? Yeah, what does that consist of?
When you think about that, when it's that much money, if whatever profession you or your wife have, you could almost like not work and just stay home and dedicate yourself into teaching those kids.
Well,
it's almost the same. It's like,
so what's crazy about this to me, which is, and it's, I can see why some people get angry about it, especially if you're like, you know, you work hard and you want your kids, everybody. Here's the thing that all parents or most parents have in common. Not all parents. Some parents are shit, but most parents have in common is that we just want what's best for our kids. We just want the best for our children. We love our kids. We want them to do well. We want them to have the same opportunities or the right opportunities. And this doesn't work that way. Life isn't like that. You know, some kids have better opportunities.
It's not the same.
And I can see why some people get angry, but the part that's crazy is that even if you have the money, let's say you've got the money, and you go to some of these schools and you're like, okay, I'm going to pay $40,000 a year. Doesn't guarantee your kid's even going to go there. It's competitive even at that level.
Wow.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
You still have to apply to get in.
You still have to apply. And it's crazy.
It's all about the network. I mean, for the most part, the education is great and the resources, but the network that they, you know, place you with, like you said, NASA, like if you have a communication channel open with fucking like people from NASA.
And when you look at it like, okay, so you
internship,
you grow up with these kids, right? So, you know, and if you have a normal childhood with friendships and relationships with other students, there's a good likelihood, especially going through a private school like that, that if you don't turn out to be or get the job at NASA, that one of your friends or what like that, like the percentage of those kids that go on to do and make really good money or go on to bigger colleges and then go on from there, like, I mean, the rates, I can't remember, I'm sure you know because you've been there, but I'd looked at it before a long time ago and it's like, it's huge difference, right?
Well, there's a lot of factors to consider too, because I was thinking about this quite a bit. I'm like, okay. Because you can look at the numbers, like if a kid goes through private school system, the odds that they go to college are far higher. They're typically, you know, they'll do better in school. Typically, the classes they'll take will be more advanced and blah, blah, blah. And these are just objective numbers. But there's a lot of factors in there, right? Like, okay, maybe the school's better. Maybe the teachers are more involved. you could make an argument that teachers may be more involved because there's more of a there's a little bit more of a motivation in the sense that in private schools, teachers, if they perform well, probably can get rewarded more. If they do bad, they'll get booted, you know, that whole thing. But then there's this other factor in the sense that the parents that can afford to send their kids to private schools, so there's that environment at home. And then maybe also the parents who send their kids to these schools may find education to be more important and place more importance on,
well,
sort of more involved.
I was just saying,
so like all these factors.
I would imagine that if I'm a parent and I'm spending $40,000 a year on my kid to go to school, I'm definitely heavily invested in his homework. What the fuck are you doing? You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm not paying $40,000 a year.
Your kid's like, I don't, you know, your kid just like, you get a note from the teacher.
Yeah.
Your kid didn't do his homework. You just see dollar signs like disappearing.
Oh, right away. So it's different, right? Like I could easily see if my kid's going to public school and those things slacking off and it's like, oh, we'll wait till report card comes out and like, hey, you need to get your grades up, whatever the case may be, right?
Yeah.
But when you're shelling out, when you're having to drive your Jetta and you don't get to drive your Lamborghini that you want.
Well, if money means something
for this little shit like to go through school. Yeah. Motherfucker better be coming home doing his homework every day, and dad will be there waiting for you to make sure you do.
He's like, Dad, I want to be an artist. Like, no, son, I'm sorry. You have to be a brain surgeon in order for me to get a return on the money I invested.
Right.
Brain surgeon or corporate attorney.
Those well, then the you got to see like the other end of that, right? Like the kid that just totally rebels, you know, like the parent that just has the money and just sends him to that school and expects it all to happen and is passive with it. I mean, it's still there.
We were actually having this conversation, ironically, this weekend. We had a bunch of family over and stuff and did paella at Katrina's family's house. And my uncle had a really rough upbringing. So did I. And, you know, my uncle's done very, very well for himself. And because of that, you know, he had kids that he put, they had everything. I mean, I remember being a kid. I'll never forget. I've shared on the show before that like Rad was like my, you know, childhood movie, right?
I still have to watch that. You guys keep talking about it.
So
send me an angel.
Right. Yes. So I always wanted like, you know, the Haro or the Mongoose bike or whatever like that. And I was like 10, 12, 13 years old. And that was like my dream bike. And, you know, my parents, I remember when I finally got a bike, it was like the BMX, like $80 bike, you know, that wasn't the $400 or $600 GT or Haro or whatever. And my cousins that were like 4 and 5 years old had like Mongoose bikes with training wheels on them.
Oh,
like,
shit.
They're not even old enough to know what the bikes they were riding.
So you got like the Rolls Royce power wheels.
Everything. My uncle,
power wheels.
I remember being a kid and they had like this huge TV in their bedroom and every video gaming system. Like they just had everything. And then, you know, I know my uncle now, him being older, he struggles with that, you know, wishing that his kids had the same drive and as he does, and they don't have it, you know, and now he's finding something. He's got three of them, you know, that he's still kind of financially helping. He's got two of them that, you know, he's paying for, and he's got another one.
It for sure doesn't guarantee success. That's a huge myth, you know what I mean? Because the drug use rate in private schools can be pretty high, and there are some public schools in California that rank pretty high, but it's typically in the ones that are, you know, super inaccessible. Like you have to buy a $3 million house to go to them or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember my business, I had a wellness studio. My wellness studio is in Los Gatos, which is a very expensive part of Silicon Valley. You know, a average house there is probably $2 million or whatever. And I remember there was like a 5-year period where there were suicides happening at the high school there. One suicide is you hear about one at a high school, and that blows you away because they're not super common. There were like three or something like that happened over the course of a 5-year period, and it makes you wonder. You know what I mean? It makes you wonder if the parents are just not involved, or if there's, I don't know. So it doesn't guarantee success, you know, whatsoever. Because you do see a lot of these like celebrity kids too, where they're super spoiled and they become just assholes and douchebags. I mean, I just want my kids to be. To fulfill, you know, to feel fulfilled and to be
at the end of the day, at the end of the day, it's always going to come back down to the parenting, right? Like we could always talk about the systems and all the shit that could be better or, oh, unfortunate.
Parents
for this.
Play the biggest role.
Yeah. However involved you are with the process.
Right.
It's going to determine things.
Right. Because so. I could see how my kid goes to private school. If I had a kid goes to private school or a public school, and I could see him turning out either way based off of really on my involvement in that whole process. You know, if you're a parent who invests $40,000 a year to put them in private school and you think that's just the answer, and so then you have a very poor relationship with your child and you just think that, oh, the school will take care of him being successful later, you're probably up for a surprise later on.
There's also, you can't forget, like, challenges in life. You know, they can forge incredible individuals. And
well, this is what my uncle was saying this weekend. He's like, you know, my biggest regrets, he says, I wish I allowed more adversity for my kids growing up. He says they needed it. Looking back now, as they're all in their late 20s and mid 20s, and he's like, and where they're at in their life, he's like, man, I guess they didn't have enough. You know, he was trying to protect him because he felt he had too much of adversity to overcome, and that's what made him to who he is today. And then by protecting them too much and not allowing them to go through some adversity, now he has these kids that just don't seem to want to struggle at all because they've had it handed to them for most of their life.
By the way, when I say that the California public schools are just terrible, I'm talking about the rankings. Like, we're 42 in the nation, by the way. So one of the richest states, if not the richest state, and we're 42 in the nation, so it is pretty bad. I'm just being objective here. It's not just my opinion. There's actual numbers.
On average,
you should see, by the way, the weight rooms of these high school gyms. Because, of course, you know,
D1 college
I'm
weight
doing,
rooms.
You know, because I'm doing the tour, you know, and it's the students that are touring us. And I was really impressed with the kids, by the way. Super, like, poised and charismatic and, you know, well-spoken. And then at the end, you can just walk around yourself. And so I'm going inside all these classrooms and stuff. And I'm like, oh, I want to go see the gym. And, dude, it's fucking platforms and, like, rubber plates and... I remember my high school gym had a universal machine, like I think one squat rack, if I'm not mistaken. It was terrible.
Ours was as big as this studio, and it was just this fart box. You know, it was horrible. It was just like squat racks and benches and like one platform and just smell.
Well, I met
duct tape on the fucking on the seats.
I was like, get me out of here. Yeah.
But I met, we all got big. I would talk to like the strength and conditioning like. I don't know if they were coaches or coordinators, if whatever you would call them. And then we were sitting there talking about programming and stuff like that. And I'm like, oh shit, like this is legit. Like they're legit, you know, strength coaches who understand exercise programming. Cause I don't remember any of that at all. But again, keep in mind, I went to high school, you know, a little while ago. You know what I mean?
It's just like yesterday.
Yeah. In the black and white days when TV was black. No, not that.
Did you just pass your 20-year reunion?
I did.
Did you go?
No.
Come on, man.
You didn't go to the 20s?
No.
What?
Dude. I don't know how many times I have to say this. School, for me...
We should have gone for
him.
...was
so unmemorable that I couldn't even... I would go and I'd be like, what? You know, like, okay. So unmemorable for me.
I want to go
Total waste of time.
I want to go to my 20.
Yeah.
Yeah. I didn't go to any of the other ones, but 20, I feel like that's a long time.
Yeah. Cause then you'll see some dramatic change in people.
A lot. Like, yeah. I know that I kind of see people on social media that I hadn't seen in years, and then, like, everybody is very, very different. So it'd just be interesting to see everybody after 20 years who's where in their life.
Dude, I enjoyed high school. Everybody talks shit about it. I enjoyed it.
So you were in a small town, kind of, though. You had a small town.
It was a tight knit community. Yeah.
That's how I think that's too.
Totally different than when you go to, when you're in a big city.
Yeah, you're probably right.
You know what I mean? Yeah. I feel like it's a different feel because I've had friends who went to those kinds of schools and it was very different.
Do you remember how, you know what though? It's funny is the high schools over here, which I don't know Justin's, but they're not that much bigger than my little small town high school. We only had one high school in the whole town. So, you know, San Jose has got like 20 something or whatever.
Shit tons of schools.
Yeah, they have like 20 something high schools, but they're all relatively, because I think there's like a range. Like once you get that like 3,000 to 5,000 students.
Yeah. I don't think it's necessarily the size of the school. It's that there's so many. So okay, so when I managed the first gym that I ever managed was a 24-hour fitness in Salinas. It's right across the street from the rodeo over there. And when I'll never forget, like my first, there was a high school game that came up like the second month or whatever, high school football game. And I remember the town was like shut down for a high school football game. I'd never seen that before.
Because
in San Jose, there's so many schools that nobody really cares. Mm-hmm. But in towns like that, it's like you see posters.
That's like
up
the thing to do. Yeah.
Yeah. It's like a big deal.
Oh,
that's how it was for us.
Our town was too. You only had one main street. And then anytime we had a home football game, like all the windows of all the stores are painted all the high school colors and the shit like that.
All downtown. They had like this one, gas station that would like you could go in and get a deal if you like wore your jersey and everything, and so they were like they would give back a lot to the high school football team.
That's awesome. You know what else I wanted to bring up? You sent me that article and someone else had sent me that article right before you. That did you see Justin?
I posted it on my Instagram.
So is it the soda companies or the artificial sweetener companies?
No. The soda companies are getting sued.
Oh,
so it's,
I didn't read
it's
that.
Diet Coke, it's Pepsi Company, it's Snapple.
Because they're saying that the aspartame, you know, they lied to them that they wouldn't make them fat.
It's making me fat.
And now there's some studies that show that it may contribute to diabetes and obesity.
So what's interesting...
Dude, this is huge.
It is huge.
People don't realize how big this is.
It is huge. And that's why I posted it.
Litigious assholes.
I posted on my Instagram.
And I'm just so divided on the way I feel about it.
Well, so do I. Okay, let me tell you why I haven't responded to anybody who's responding on my page right now, because I don't want people to... I'd rather talk about it on the show where I can explain myself, because...
Yeah.
There's parts of it that I'm pro. Like, I'm all for the law. I'm all for people suing them. And then there's parts of me that are just like, take responsibility for yourself, right?
Because you want to keep them accountable, right, for, like, putting shit out there. But at the same time, you're the ones that are consuming it.
Right. And that's where I'm a little torn. But when I read about the news article about it, I'm more in support than I am against. Because, so this is different than when people sued McDonald's for making them obese. Because at the time...
Well, McDonald's isn't marketing themselves as a place to diet either.
That's right.
Diet sodas are presenting themselves like, like this is a better way, this is a healthier way for you to eat.
So they're not suing...
It'd be different if McDonald's came out and said, this is the
healthiest way to eat.
Yeah, this is fast food weight loss, then I think that I would be more behind those lawsuits.
This is similar to... reminds me of when people sued the tobacco companies because the tobacco companies came out and said, we don't cause cancer, we're not addictive. Then the studies came out and they're like, it does cause cancer. So then the family members of people who got lung cancer sued them.
Mm-hmm.
It's similar in the sense because when I'm reading the news articles, it says that they're being sued for misleading ads.
Yeah.
And what they're misleading, what's misleading is that the artificial sweeteners boost cravings for high calorie foods, promote inflammation, affect the vascular system, and alter hormones in the microbiome. Which is true. It is true. Studies are showing that, and more studies are coming out to support that. So, and it is a bit misleading, right? Because diet sodas, it's like a healthy alternative. It's good for you.
Exactly. It's different. If they were to have named it a long time ago as aspartame Coke, or called it, whatever, Coke, and it wasn't called Diet Coke or Diet Snapple or Diet. I mean, when you put that in there, you're implying that this is for people that are trying to lose weight.
For you.
Yeah, that it's healthier for you, that it's better for you, or which also takes us back to the whole discussion of the shakes and using that as a weight loss strategy, and like we talked about with that one doctor that one day. So I'm torn on how I feel because I believe that. Obviously, we should all be accountable, and I don't believe in suing people because we're too dumb to see through advertising. But it is very misleading when you think about where we've been going with diabetes and obesity in the last 10, 15 years. We're getting worse before we're getting better. So here you have products like this that are supposed to be on the market to help people, and in reality, it's probably accelerating the issue that's happening right now because people are confused on what's happening to them. They have no idea because they're not educating themselves. So that's partially their own fault. But then if these lawsuits don't happen, then who's going to finally stop?
How are you going to bring awareness?
Right.
Yeah. And so that's the only angle I really see. And I do understand where you're coming from with that because I'm just repulsed by all the lawsuits that exist out there. I feel like...
it's so litigious. The society is so litigious.
I'm so over it. I'm so over people not taking responsibility for what they're doing and trying to just take down whoever they can to profit off of them. And I understand it from, real like circumstantial cases where it makes sense. But like the overall like theme of today is like way overly litigious.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm
for sure.
Over it.
For sure. But this is such a big people. I don't think a lot of people realize how big of a deal this is.
This is going to shift some shit real quick.
If they win, which I doubt, and I'll tell you why I doubt that they're going to win. I doubt they're going to win because the companies that manufacture and make these products are massive, and
they're all going to get together.
And they're going to make they're going to say all we have said is that these sodas don't have calories and don't have sugar, and that can help you lose weight, which you can make that case. The sewers are trying to say, hey, this is bad for us, and you're not telling us. And then they're going to say, we didn't know it was bad for you because the studies are inconclusive. In fact, the FDA is still saying that. So I don't think they're going to win. But if they did win, holy fuck, that would set a precedence that would destroy these companies. Because everybody would come out of the woodworks and would start suing these companies and right.
No matter what, it's going to shake some shit up.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah.
And we called it. We called this a long time ago. Like the market is shifting.
I'm going to make another call in right now because they've had it for, I think, 4+ years now. And we're barely starting to see it be advertised. Watch the push in advertising the Green Cokes now. Watch the push on that. They've had them for over 4 years. Many people that have heard this show and us have talked about them a bunch of times.
Institute Plan C.
It's 100%. You got to know, like, that's how smart these companies are, right? Yep. They've had it in place for, this is like, pull the parachute now. Fucking
yeah.
We head over here while everybody else wasn't prepared. And I don't know how many of these other companies have done what like Coca-Cola did by having this line that is real sugar and stevia, so you get kind of the best of both worlds. It's a little bit lower calorie, and then it's used a natural sweetener instead of something like aspartame. So I'm really interested to see if all of a sudden we start seeing these commercials and stuff pop up like crazy.
It's already going to start because now it's mainstream. Like mainstream is talking about this. So people are going to, what's going to happen is it's going to spark a lot of debate. You're going to see people talking about, like, on the one hand, you're going to have people say, no, they're perfectly safe. And then on the other hand, you're going to have people saying, no, these studies are showing this. So now it's in the mainstream and people are going to talk about it. It's going to be very interesting. I'm very interested to see what ends up happening. Here's the thing. If I'm a company and I'm making sodas, I'm just going to say, like, I'm going to put on the bottle, made with real sugar or made with, like, I'm not going to try to pretend, what I mean?
Yeah.
That something's not what it is. Like, hey, it's a donut, you know? Donut with sugar. It's good. Whatever. You know, like, like, it's okay. That then you won't get sued. Right, and I don't think that'll stop people from eating.
Well, gone are those days, right? That you could be sort of vague about, you know, what's in your product. Like people want to know exactly what's in there. Yeah. And that's why I'm so surprised that whole, you know, it didn't pass about, like, labeling with GMO and everything here. It's just like, it's crazy to me.
Some states that passed those laws are getting overturned from the federal government.
Yeah.
That they can't label. That don't get me started on that. That's a whole other.
It's fucking absurd
world.
To me.
So I didn't know that. I didn't know that we had some states that actually passed that. So some states actually started to put GMO on anything that had GMO in it.
And then there was some federal laws that were an act that was passed that said you can't label, that states can't label, to try and over to say no, sorry. I think Vermont was one, and Hawaii, and there's a lot of power there that's happening, and where the federal government then steps in and tells the states, no, you can't label.
Of course.
Which is like,
you're fucking weird. You're fucking with corn and wheat, dude.
Yeah.
Corn and wheat is right up there with cigarettes and alcohol and fucking, that's right up there, dude. It's like, what's part of the tobacco, guns, cigarettes, and fucking wheat and corn, dude. Yeah. It's right up there with the fucking five killers, dude. It's just, you better believe someone's coming to the rescue on that.
Yeah, no, it's crazy.
Oh, shit. Anyway. Bring on the bird.
This quaz brought to you by Organifi. For those days you fall short on getting your organic veggies or whole food nutrition, Organifi fills the gap with laboratory-tested, certified organic superfoods to help give your health and performance the added edge. Try Organifi totally risk-free for 60 days by going to Organifi.com. That's Organifi.com. And use the coupon code MINDPUMP for 20% off at checkout.
All right, first up is 1112 Lauren asking, what are your hobbies outside of fitness and optimization? If you don't have any, do you think it impacts you in terms of being more holistic in your abilities and perspective?
Hobbies outside of fitness and optimization?
Outside of fitness and
constantly
optimization.
Constantly optimizing.
So nothing related to fitness or optimization. So we can't be like, I go and I do the float tank. That's part of my hobby. Or I go and I do stuff that's optimizing. Like, just purely out of entertainment. What do you enjoy to do on your...
Well, this right now, what I'm doing that I love is watching Stranger Things. You guys see the new Stranger Things?
Yeah, dude. I didn't watch it yet.
It's great.
It's so good.
Yeah.
How many episodes you watch?
I had four. No, you watch four? Three.
God, yeah. Sometimes I can get into TV... and I'll watch the fuck out of it.
Well, it's crazy now they release that new season and it's like the whole thing's there. It's like, how do people like control themselves not to watch all of them at once?
Oh, dude.
Yeah, it's just all
I was
there.
Almost late to something yesterday.
I had to control myself.
I was watching it. Otherwise, hobbies, I'm trying to think.
Well, even that one.
Because I really, really enjoy doing things that tend to also... optimize, but not necessarily because they optimize. Does that make sense?
You're not thinking about it while
I could even argue, okay, so it says if you don't have any, do you think the impacts of you in terms of being more holistic in your abilities and perspective? I think you could even put a spin on, watching Netflix series occasionally, right? Because I think there's this fine line of the consumption, right? Like, are you letting yourself get sucked into it and addicted to it and you burn 4 or 5 hours every day being sucked into Netflix? Sure. Or is it something that provides a release from you because you're normally working and focused on business and the kids and everybody else, and then it allows you this time to actually detach a little bit? Because for me, that's kind of, I love movies. I love like Netflix series. I still manage to find them into my life, but I'm also reading and doing playing sports and doing other things besides just that. I'm not letting that completely consume my life, but there's a part of it that I really do. When I watch a series, I feel like it allows me to kind of shut my brain off. I become engulfed in the story that I forget about all the stuff that I have to handle that day and tomorrow.
Yeah.
And so I think there's something healthy about that comes from that.
Of course. People, what sometimes we look at entertainment and we look at it as a waste of time and money, and it can be abused. Like anything can be abused. Even fitness can be abused. But if it's not being abused, entertainment plays a valuable role in society because, like you're saying, Adam, it could be a way to relax, a way to, you know, be in the present. Mm-hmm. It could be a way to enjoy your company around you, to bond with other people. It could definitely increase the value.
Alter your mood.
Yeah.
I mean, there's all kinds of benefits to it. And I go through this a lot because I'm always thinking about how to spend my time when I'm home and be more effective and be more present and all that kind of stuff, which is definitely an optimizing kind of mentality where, you know, I want to spend as much time as I can with my kids while they're young and, you know, they're here and we'll go, like, I'll teach them how to, you know, throw a ball and we'll go outside and we'll play catch and all that stuff. And I'm like, just, I'm trying to be as like focused as I can on what we're doing together. But yeah, like then there's times where I'll just sneak off into the room and I'll just start playing guitar, and that's strictly for myself. And I it brings me peace and it calms me down.
Do you actually still do that? Do you actually still get away and do that for yourself?
I mean, not very frequently, but when I do, it's like it makes like a real big impact on me because it's just like I just feel like, I don't know, like it's really just my thing, nobody else's thing.
Yeah.
So
I think that's actually really important that you have these things. Last year I bought Katrina, I think for her birthday, like a whole snowboard setup and everything like that, so I can get back into riding. And this year the goal was to get in a lot. I got in a few rides last year, and just it felt amazing. And it felt amazing because I used to say, and I said this all through my 20s, like if somebody asks like where are you in your zen, or where is your most like special, where's your special place, right? And my special place was, you know, being up on top of a mountain and just a beautiful day and the sun and the board strapped up, headphones in my ear and all alone. Like I don't have to be with anybody. I can share that with somebody, but for me, it's one of the most peaceful, relaxing, enjoyable moments. And I always find when I do that, it rejuvenates me for everything else. And I'm a better version of myself when I get back from doing that. And so this year, a major goal was for me to get back into that. I mean, I used to be a season pass holder where I was going every free weekend that I had. I'd be up there and I'd be riding. And I noticed how happy I am. And then I realized that as we get older, you know, other things become a priority. And that's how these things start to kind of take a back seat, because we become so focused on the business, our children, our partners, bills, all this mortgages, all this stuff that becomes so important. But those things too, you know, it's no different than how we talk about stresses in your life, right? Like if you're a type A personality and all you do is add stress, all these things that are pressure and stress on your life, and you forget to do some of these things that actually allow you to escape from that, you lose balance. And I mean, I definitely have lost balance in my, especially the last 10 years, because I've been so heavily focused on, you know, growth and finances and things like that, that I stopped doing some of these things. And I stopped doing them because I felt like I had to let them go if I was going to excel at these other things. But it's not true. It's just like the meditation thing we talk about. It seems like, oh, I have to take an hour out of my day to meditate. Like it's going to take away from something. But in reality, it's amazing how it rejuvenates you when you have these escapes. And so for me, like for sure, two big things that I noticed in my life, and this is just literally this last year, this is a big deal for me. I cut back on snowboarding a lot, which was really important to me, and watching sports that I love. Football and basketball are two things that I grew up my whole life, you know, just heavily into it. And it was something I shared with my best friends. And over the years, I've fallen off that because it takes time. It takes time to follow up on your sports and watch the games.
Drop the ball on that one.
Right. And so I kind of like let it go to waste. But, you know, this year I'm back to watching my team play football, catching the Warriors playing ball. And I really fucking enjoy it. I'm a happier person when I'm allowing those things into my life and finding that balance. So I think.
Yeah, that's why this question is interesting, because, you know, what are your hobbies outside of fitness and optimization? I understand the fitness part, but a hobby, unless it's something that you're obsessed with and you abuse, it's always optimization, right? Even if it's not in that category of optimization, like,
right,
you know, brain hacking or whatever, if it's a real hobby and you're not abusing it and you're not obsessed with it, it's going to optimize your life.
Right.
No matter what, it could be stamp collecting. I mean, if it's something you're into and it brings value to your life, and again, you're not obsessed with it or it's not an addiction, then that's optimization. As a kid, I never really had a ton of hobbies. I did like reading, but it was always, I would always read biographies or, you know,
science
books or encyclopedia type stuff. So you know, when I was a real young kid, I really liked reading the Book of World Records, Book of World Records was real fun for me, you know. But it was always fact stuff, like stuff that I could learn that was like real. I wasn't into fiction, so that was kind of a hobby. But you know, I collected baseball cards and football cards and comic books, but that wasn't really a huge like passion of mine. It's been fitness since I was 13, and it's just, I love the history of it. I love the history of bodybuilding. I love the history of strength athletes. I love the history of supplements, the history of, you know, nutrition. I love learning about I've always been into that. So it's almost like when people ask me like, what else are you into? I feel kind of bad saying it, but why? You know what I mean? It's just something I've always really enjoyed. I got really into jiu-jitsu in my 20s, and I did that for about 6 years. But the one thing that's always been a constant, at least since I was my early teens, was fitness. But it truly is my favorite hobby. There's nothing comes close to, you know, just enjoying reading about it and learning about it and doing it and, you know, anything that has to do with it. So other than that, I can't think of too many of the things that I kind of get into. I sound kind of boring, huh?
I just really love fitness.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
What else is there?
Next question is Lucas Hunt 10. Do you have a go-to routine to bounce back after a night of drinking?
I have
three Advils and a gallon of water.
Yeah, I have a protocol that I do the night that when I am drinking, and then what I, you know, so what I do while I'm drinking, what I do before bed, and it seems to work. Rule number one, if you want to avoid feeling super shitty the next day, don't overdrink. That's in the rule number one. So I don't think there's any magic that you can do. Yeah, I don't think there's like any magic potion you can take that'll completely eliminate that.
Well, I heard something about theanine. I think somebody was talking about supplementing that and that lowering. I don't even think, like, you could drink more and you wouldn't be as inebriated taking this. I don't know if you know much about theanine.
So substances that allow you to drink more alcohol so that you feel you feel better while you're drinking.
Right.
It's not protecting you. Yeah. It may be giving you the impression that you're, it's like when people do drugs, like, you know, I've actually hung out with people who will do, you know, who are friends with other people who are doing drugs. I remember one time I went to Vegas with a buddy of mine, and then we hung out with this other group, and that's not really my scene to do a shit ton of, you know, party drugs or whatever. But some of these guys and girls in this other group were doing just cocaine all night long. It was my first time really ever even being around it. And I remember them saying like, oh, I love it, man. Like, I could drink more when I'm on it. And I remember thinking like,
that's probably not going to pay off.
Yeah. I don't think that might not be a good thing. Like, I kind of like the fact that I get drunk easier. I don't need to drink as much.
Whoa, it was a whole bottle,
Jack.
Causes
much damage. But one thing that I do is I do make sure to drink lots of water. I do have electrolytes, so I'll take electrolytes with me. Because if you just drink tons of water, you
can
actually
throw. What about just drinking the green juice right there?
I haven't done it yet with the green juice, but that's actually quite smart.
Well, so this funny that this question got brought up because literally this weekend, this is what I did. And so I was going to ask you what you thought. I mean, I felt good afterwards because I don't drink hardly at all. Like,
you have a pretty bad reaction to alcohol.
Yeah, and that's why I don't drink, you know, and it sucks because my family, Katrina's family, like, food and alcohol, like, every event is surrounded around that. And, you know, it's such a big deal when somebody in her family sees me pick up a beer. Everybody makes it, like, it makes a whole big old ordeal about it. Oh, shit, Adam's drinking. Well, everybody gets excited. It's like a big deal, you know, like, oh, my God, I'm going to drink, right? We're going to party all night. I'm like, whoa, dude, I'm just going to have some beers, you know? So I had, I think I had 4 beers, which for me, that's a lot because I don't drink at all. You know, I'm by 2, I'm already feeling pretty buzzed. 3, 4, it's got me pretty drunk, you know, because I'm a total lightweight. But I also know that because I don't, and the reason why, I always feel like shit the next day. So I last night I had I took actually the green juice after I was done drinking. So this was the night before last. Sorry. The green juice after I was done drinking before I went to bed, and I actually washed down a probiotic and then a probiotic in the morning time, and I feel fucking really good, dude. I actually that's the best I have felt.
So you did the Organifi green juice. Did you do their probiotic too?
The only reason why I did because I normally wouldn't even think to try that, but because we
hooked this up with
I have these probiotics in my house, and I'm like, and I'm not, I do kombucha occasionally, and it's one of those things. I don't really seem to have a lot of gut issues, but if I ever do, it's like when I drinking messes my gut up. So I thought, you know what? Maybe I'm gonna try taking a probiotic tonight.
It's funny you say that because that's part of my protocol. Part of my protocol is I do the electrolytes, water, and then I do probiotic that night. And if I'm drinking heavily, I'll do activated charcoal while I'm drinking. Activated charcoal does
absorbs the toxins.
It binds to toxins, making them so that you can't absorb them, and then you excrete
them.
See,
I might be from the old school, but I feel like you need to suffer through that shit. You fucking bitch.
So,
if you drank too much, that's your fault.
Do you actually know what actually causes us to feel the hungover feeling that we feel?
Yeah, so
inflammation in the liver?
It's the spike. It's the hard spike of blood sugar, and it's the hard crash of coming back down. Think about it. You are loading all this alcohol, right? So blood sugar, and one after another, one beer, two beer, three beer, four beer. So your blood sugar is going, it's taking off. And then all of a sudden you pass out, right? Boom, you pass out and you go to sleep. It's that huge spike to a huge drop, which is also why people, the old take the hair off the dog and you have a, you know, Bloody Mary.
Is that what you say?
Yeah, is it what it is? That.
Isn't it? Is it like hair that. Of the dog?
Take a hair of, what is it?
I know it's not that.
I like Adam's version.
What is it?
I know it's not take the hair off the dog.
What is it?
I think it's hair of the dog.
Is it hair of the dog?
Yeah, hair of the dog.
What is it, Doug?
Google it. I don't know.
It's a
hair of the dog.
Oh, Doug knows.
It's a colloquial expression in the English language predominantly used to refer to alcohol that is consumed with the aim of lessening the effects of a hangover. Take the hair off the dog.
What is it? What is it?
Hey,
what is it?
Hair of the dog.
Oh, hair of the dog. That was fucking close, bro.
I feel bad for your dogs. Like, oh shit, I'm a Hey Bentley, come over here, just shave the fuck out of him.
So it shows you how much I drink, right? Have to do this.
It's like throwing a monkey in the wrench.
I like it.
So it spikes it back up, right? So it mitigates how much of the crash is. So if you have this huge spike, you shut it down all night long, and then you wake up and that fucking headache is the crash.
So there's a lot of factors that come into play that affect you the next
hydration,
day.
Hydration, things like that.
Part of it is there's a dehydration aspect that happens, and there's a layer that surrounds your brain that when you become dehydrated gets tight and causes headaches. It can actually cause you to feel pressure in your head. There's also the alterations of certain chemicals like dopamine, serotonin, GABA. So GABA is a neurotransmitter that's a depressant. It makes you feel relaxed. Alcohol increases the amount of GABA that's put in the brain. That's why when you drink alcohol, you get relaxed and feel good. But what goes up must come down, right. And the body does adapt to what it considers to be abnormal levels of anything. Anything in the body that gets abnormally high or low, the body adapts by downregulating receptors, reducing its own production of these chemicals, and so on. So when you're pushing out all this GABA with alcohol, then when the alcohol wears off, your brain is producing less GABA than it normally would, which is why people who suffer from anxiety, for example, they will... this is why alcohol is not a good treatment for anxiety. If you, while you're drunk, you may feel less anxiety. The hangover, you talk to anybody with anxiety issues, they'll tell you the day after, terrible.
Well, I imagine, because it goes up and then crashes back down the other direction.
Terrible anxiety. Dopamine is another one. When you cause dopamine to spike, which lots of substances cause a high spike in dopamine, but especially alcohol and drugs, the brain responds to high levels of dopamine very quickly. It very quickly downregulates receptors, reduces its own production of dopamine, which it may, give you that depressed feeling the day after. Because a hangover isn't just the physical feelings of headache and throwing up.
It's shame.
It's you also
just like, oh no.
The Justin's walk, the blow, yeah,
Justin, why do just, I have shit written just, all over my face?
Justin's had the walk of shame a few times.
You wake up, look next to you in the bed. Yes,
walking down,
who's this?
Walking out of some sorority house.
Oh, shit. Oh my God, I got these chunks on my shirt.
Why am I in bed with Doug?
Oh, Lord.
Yeah, but there's a lot of things that characterize a hangover that aren't just, you know, headache and physical shit. It's also the emotional feeling, because I've had hangovers the day after where I don't have a headache. I don't necessarily physically feel, you know, bad, but emotionally I'm like flat. You know what I mean?
What's your thought about like shrooms or ashwagandha or any of that type of stuff? What's your thoughts on that?
So it makes sense that like an adaptogen like ashwagandha would be a good thing to take the day after, but I don't want people to take that to heart. Do some research, because alcohol interacts with a lot of different substances, and the interaction is what's important. So you may take something that sounds like it sounds like a good idea and it's natural, but it may actually make things worse. So I'll give you another example. Passion flower. Passion flower is a natural treatment for anxiety, for acute anxiety. It's actually quite effective. Like if you take passion flower and you're having an acute episode of anxiety, it can give you some effects. But so maybe someone's going to think, oh shit, you know, I'm going to take passion flower afterwards and make me feel better. Well, passion flower, the way it works, is it raises GABA also. So if you take passion flower with alcohol, it might not be a good thing. It might make you more drunk, or the day after it might just be kicking the can down the road, where now it's like, you know, like anything else, like I keep trying to get that GABA, don't let my brain reacclimate, and then I make the hangover worse. Nootropics are an interesting one. So like the racetams, you'll hear people say, oh, if I take, you know, paracetam or whatever, and then I drink, I only have to drink one drink and I get buzzed way faster, and, you know, this and that. Or if I take it the next day. And when we went down to LA and met with, who was the guy we met with?
The quality guy?
No, he was the where you hook up your brain to the video game.
Andrew Hill.
Yeah, Andrew Hill.
Yeah, I brought it up to him, and he goes, yeah, it's probably doing more damage to your brain by combining the two. Do not combine nootropics with alcohol, because you'll read on the forums.
I'm glad you actually said that, because going back to the last episode we did where we talked about this nootropic kick right now that everybody's on, that will be something I'm sure people are already
nootropic
trying.
Alcohol.
Yeah.
Watch, dude. Yeah. Watch.
Oh, I'm smart while I'm doing dumb stuff.
Yeah. No, I think the best thing you can do is, for what I found, make sure you're hydrated, electrolytes, activated charcoal if you have if your stomach feels off. Probiotic was very, very smart from Adam. And here's the other thing too, is I feel way better if I drink during the day, because then it wears off and then I can sleep at night. I think part of the reason why you feel shitty the next day is because you stay up late and then you can't sleep when you try to sleep. So you feel shitty because of that too.
Oh, it's a combination.
Day drinking is the best.
Day drinking, you don't feel nearly as
shitty. So much more fun.
Here's
anyway.
Here's a proto. I didn't even think about this. This was something, because I don't drink like I used to drink when I was a kid. Like, so when I had my condo, the complex, like a whole circle of the entire complex was almost a mile. And so if I came home and I was like staggering drunk, where I knew like hangover tomorrow, potentially throwing up tonight or tomorrow, I'm so bad, I would walk until I walked it off. I would literally walk around my complex like stump for hours. And I would just keep, if I felt that,
I like to go for a drive.
No, like one of the worst.
just kidding, total joke.
That's a joke. No, literally though, that's one of the best things you can do if you pushed it too far, is don't lay down and go to sleep. Laying down, going to sleep, and you're already feeling nauseous and a headache and going, oh, it's just going to get worse.
Oh, I hate that feeling.
If you go and you
that's
move, you know, move, spins. Move, burn it off, use it, you know, just keep moving. And so I just keep walking and walking until I started to feel better, and then I come home.
What's the sickest you guys have ever gotten with alcohol? Like, what's the one like that you can remember?
So my 21st That's birthday, I had a weird experience. I had the first time I had drank so much alcohol so fast that my body just rejected it. Mm-hmm. And I actually didn't get really sick from this, but my body, I never felt my body reject it like this. And it was because I had done, my buddies first hand me this big, one of those, you remember those big glass beer mugs? Mm-hmm. You know, it's like three beers or whatever, two and a half, three beers.
Steins.
One of those big old glass ones, right?
Yeah.
And, you know, a couple beers are in there. I don't know how many fit in there. I know it's at least two. And they had me pound that, you know, pound, pound. They're all, it's my 21st birthday, right? So I do that.
Of course.
Then they hand me the bong to take a bong rip. I take a bong rip right to that. And then they hand
great combo.
And then they hand me a beer bong that has 3.5 beers in it, right? And I slam the beer bong. And as soon as the beer gets all the way into my stomach, I pull the tube out, and it just projectile vomit. I've never projectile vomited in my life before. It just all got right out. It went flying out of my mouth like a tube of it. And I actually, after it got out, I felt
you didn't even have time to absorb it.
Yeah, that's what happened. It rejected probably three beers, full beers, just straight out. My body just said, no, that was too much, too fast, too soon.
Wow, dude.
And so that happened on my 21st. And then I'm trying to think of some other times. It was really sick.
I got a story before Justin, because I know Justin's going to have the best.
No, I'm not.
I know you are. I went to Vegas with two of my friends. One was my business partner. So when I first opened my wellness facility, I actually co-owned it with somebody for the first couple of years before, you know, I bought him out, and then it was just mine. And I went with him and this other guy, and we went to Vegas. And one of the guys I went with is this English dude, and the English can fucking drink. It's like the Irish. It's part of the culture. It's what they do after work. So we go to the bars, and we just start going hard. Like one after another. And we're having a great time. We're drinking. And I look over at my business partner and he's got this strange look on his face. Like, yeah. And we were in Vegas for the Olympia, by the way.
Like,
No, he was just like, you know, the 1,000-mile stare where the dude's just staring forward.
He's just gone.
And he's kind of like, you know, he's kind of wavering from side to side.
Yeah.
And I tap him on the arm. I'm like, yo, I'm like, you okay, buddy? You all right? And he doesn't even say anything. He just shakes his head. No. So I'm like, oh, fuck. And so this is like 3 hours into, like, we're just going hard. So I'm like, oh, shit. I'm like, do you think you're going to throw up? And he's like, yes. So I'm like, all right, let's go. I'm going to take you to the bathroom. So I say, let's go. So he can't stand up. So now I know this is bad. So I put his arm on my shoulder and I walk him to the nearest bathroom in the casino. We go in there and he goes, I got to piss. So I'm like, all right, dude, like, here's the urinal. So I put him up, I bring him up to the urinal, and he falls. So he falls to the bathroom. So I'm like, oh, shit, like, what do I do? So I held him up, and he pulls his pants all the way down to his ankles, and he's peeing at the urinal, and I'm holding him from behind.
You're holding him.
Yes, this is what a good friend I am, dude.
Wow.
Like just bare butt cheeks.
That's intimate.
Bare butt cheeks.
Yeah.
And I'm not, like, holding, like you could... You, right now, you're probably picturing that he's at arm's length and my hand's on his shoulders.
Yeah,
no,
yeah.
He can't keep his balance, and he's a big fucking dude. My old business partner was a 240-pound bodybuilder. Okay, so he was a difficult motherfucker to support. So I had to, like, semi-embrace him. So I had, like, one underhook.
Were other dudes coming in?
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Hey, what's going on over here?
Oh, no. Dudes are coming in. We got a few, like dudes that were like, yeah. Like,
yeah, get after
so
it.
I had one underhook under his right arm, and my left arm, I grabbed his shirt, and I turned my body away because I'm like, I am not pressing my dick up against your bare ass while you're taking a piss. So now he's pissing. He's having trouble aiming, and I'm like, yeah, definitely not going to help you with that, buddy. Pulls his shit up. I walk him up to the room, and I fucking put him in the bed. He's laying there. Fucking take his shoes off. I put a big glass of water next to him. Like, are you going to be okay? Because I'm not done. I'm going to go downstairs.
Yeah, I got more to do.
So I leave him there. I leave. I go back downstairs, party some more. I come back at 2 a.m., and probably the most frightening moment of my life. Okay, have you guys ever thought your friend was dead?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, it's scary because you're like, I'm going to get in trouble. So I go up to, that's the first thing. Like, oh, no, he's dead. Oh, fuck, I'm fucked.
Oh, no.
I'm not going to tell his girlfriend. So I walk in the room, and he's not in the bed. I'm like, what the fuck? Where did he go? So I look over to the bathroom, and I'm looking, like, you can't see directly in the bathroom. You could just kind of see sideways, you know, like I can't go in until I walk around the corner. But I see his leg sticking out. Like, he's on the floor. So I'm like, oh, fuck. What, did he fall and hit his head? Yeah. And I walk in there, and he's laying on his face, and there's puke everywhere. Oh. And so I'm like, did he die? So I'm like waking him up, and no, he's not dead. I felt his pulse, and he's kind of waking up. And I'm like, dude. And he was burning up. So I'm like, this fucker's like, is this alcohol poisoning? Like, what's going on?
Oh, my God.
So I'm like, dude, let me call an ambulance. He's like, no, don't call an ambulance. He's like, I'm just really hot, dude. I'm just really hot. I'm like, just leave me here. So I'm like, all right, I'm going to leave you on the floor, but I'm going to be right over here. So I go lay down and I set my alarm. So every hour I woke up to check on him. After about the third hour, I wake up and I check and he's not on the floor now. So now I'm freaked out. I go in there. He's in the bathtub, totally naked in a cold tub. And I'm like, and he's fucking almost passed out. And I'm like, you're going to drown, dude. You can't lay in a bathtub. He's like, I'm too hot. I'm like, I don't care. Like, you're going to fucking slip and die in the bathtub. So I had to drain the water and pick his big, wet, naked ass up out of that fucking bathtub and put him in bed again. And he owes me, dude.
Oh my God.
That's all I'm going to say. From
that's
now
a lot
on,
of work, man.
From now, if I ever have to kill someone and bury them, I'm calling him first because he knows he owes me for doing that shit.
You just saved his life.
I had to.
Dude, you just reminded me of a fucking crazy story that we used to do. So so this is my senior year in high school. And talking about, you know, Justin and I, small towns, big football towns. So my senior year, I didn't play ball at all and I worked. But what I did do is I was at every game. Like, so I was, you know, all my buddies were players and stuff. And that we would go to all the event. We'd travel to all the away games and the home games. We would rope off an area that was like, and we were the rowdy group. Every touchdown, we dogpiled each other, and we were crazy and loud. And we'd show up to the game blitzed already. So that was like that. We would go somewhere, we would pre-drink because we're in high school, so you're not supposed to be doing this shit, right? So we pre-drink somewhere else. We show up hammered at the games. Well, one of the games is a home game. We were my buddy got really wasted. And we're sitting, and there's about three of the rows are all our friends. So there's about 15 of us that are all friends, and we're all together. And I'm on one side. My buddy, who is just like really, he's like his face is in his hands, and he's just kind of holding himself up, and you can just tell he's any moment he's ready to get sick. And then my other buddy's on the other side of him, and he's drunk, and he's just having a good time and being loud. And he keeps fucking with my buddy. Like every like 10 minutes or so, he grabs him and he would shake him and he'd be like, hey, the cops are coming. And then my buddy
just
would
fuck with him.
Yeah, just to fuck with him. And my buddy would sit up and try and act normal. And you could just see he was just done, right? He was totally done. And I kept telling my buddy Gary to stop doing this. I'm like, Gary, dude, leave him alone, man. He's just like, ugh. He just thought it was so funny that he would scare him every 5 minutes because he would start to fall asleep in his hands. Then he would shake him, you know, like, oh, the cops, they see you, you know? And so he'd keep doing this to him. About the third time he did this to him, my buddy sits up, opens his eyes, and just projectile vomits all over the row in front of him. All down the back of the neck of another one of my buddies. And my buddy steps up, and he's got vomit down the back of his shirt, all over his neck. It was a mess, dude. It was really bad.
God damn it.
Yeah, they ripped his shirt off. He wanted to fight my other buddy. It was just this whole ordeal. We got hella busted, dude. It was obvious that
alcohol's
this point.
Alcohol's fucked up.
Yeah. It's bad. Yeah, I guess I'll tell mine. Mine was, I've had a few, but this one was probably, like, I thought I had alcohol poisoning, I think. Like, it was pretty bad. It was an idea that we had. There was me and my friend Joe, who, you know, I get in the most trouble with him, I'll be honest.
He's all my friend Joe, yeah. God bless his soul.
I know, he's still alive. Okay. You know, we're still cool. But he's like my drinking buddy, and he's half Irish, half Italian, and so, you know, we always would talk about doing something for St. Patrick's Day, and so I'd go to the city with him, or we'd go somewhere, you know, where we could find a cool pub to hang out, and so I actually had this little house that me and Courtney just got married, and so I have this little house to myself, have this backyard, picket fence, and all that, and so I had him over, and this was like maybe 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and I was like, you know, let's get started, you know, let's start this now, and then later tonight, you know, we can go hit up a cool bar and all that, and when Courtney gets off work, she can, you know, meet up with us. And so we're out there in lawn chairs just talking shit. Like, he brought like a full case of Guinness, and I had some Bailey's, and I had some Irish whiskey. So I'm like, perfect, let's do some car bombs. Yeah, so we started doing car bombs. Did 8 car bombs in a row.
Oh,
and then like kept going too. And then it's
God,
like
I think my record is like 4, dude.
Jesus
like,
Christ.
Where it got to me though, I think it was the 9th where I was like, there was no more Baileys, and so it was just like,
yeah, whiskey dropping into, you know, Guinness. And I was like, and the, you know, the gurgle started to happen a little bit. I was just like, wow. And I was looking at the fence and I was like starting yelling profanities at like neighbors that weren't even there. Oh my God. You know? And then he was yelling at me and then we were yelling and like he was stumbling over to like some other part of the backyard and like he fell and then he was in this like ditch and had like face first in like a planter's box. You know, he just said shit all over him, and I was yelling, and then I started projectile vomiting over the fence.
Oh my God, dude!
And then, like, we—I guess in this whole time, we had called my other friend to come over and hang out with us. And then by that time, he got there. Like, I was leaning into the fence, like motionless, and my friend was leaning, like he was down face first in this planter's box. My friend was like, "Holy shit, what happened?" And he was like trying to. Trying to get us to calm down, all that, and then we like I ended up actually just going to bed.
Yeah,
it was like 4 o'clock in the afternoon. That was it. That was the end of the story. I didn't even make it out.
Did you ever get into bear fights? Did you ever have a bear fight before?
Bear fights?
Yeah. Oh, there you go, kids.
That sounds like a gay.
Tell me.
This is for all you kids out there that are into drinking.
Bear fight.
Bear fight. Yeah. Run back.
I'm scared to Google that. Yeah. I don't know what's gonna pop up.
Google it. It is a drink. It's a Jaeger bomb followed by a Irish car bomb.
Oh man.
You do back to back.
That's an appropriate name.
It's called a bear fight.
That is an appropriate name.
Yeah. We used to drink that. We run two of those. We come. We'd show up to a place. We'd order two each, and then it'd be game over for the night, dude. Just done. You're done after that.
It's the speed. You know? Like really, like it's such a bad idea. Yeah. Like what a stupid idea
for all the kids out there.
Yeah, don't do it.
Check out a bear fight.
Next up is Michael Burns, 33. Is there more of a benefit having someone spot you on the bench where they help with the rep versus just lowering the weight on the bar and doing the same number of reps without any help?
So this is comparing a forced rep
versus working out by
to
yourself.
You doing it on your own. So let's talk about what a forced rep is. Now I remember back in the day, I got a Flex magazine. God, this is some of the benefits of having a photographic memories. I can literally picture, if somebody can find this, send me a picture of this. It was a Flex magazine article. And it was a mass building. I forgot the title. It was Mass Building Secrets, and it had a picture of Mike Matarazzo, who was this bodybuilder in the 90s that I was a huge fan of. He ended up passing away not too long ago, but he had these massive arms, and it was Flex, right? Mass Building Secrets, and I bought this, and I was so fucking pumped to buy this. It must have been like, I want to say 1994 or 95, and
crazy.
I open it. And in the magazine, there's an article of like principles of mass building and of principles of like cutting or something like that, right? So I didn't give a shit about the cutting. Didn't read those. But I looked at all the principles for mass building. And what they were naming were these high intensity training techniques, these Weider principles or training techniques that were great for building mass, according to this magazine. And of course, we all know Flex magazine at that time, maybe still today, puts out shit information. But anyway, the techniques were all like partial reps and forced reps and drop sets and like super high intensity things, which I of course did all of them in the same workout. Like I'm like, oh cool, this set I'm gonna do partial reps, forced reps. I ended up burning myself out. And I learned very quickly that these high intensity techniques should be used super rarely. And what a forced rep is when you're going to failure on an exercise, like let's say I'm doing curls and I'm working out with Justin, and
would never happen.
We'd never do curls. Yeah. But let's just say we did. Let's say we got
hypothetically.
So, yeah, whatever. I'm doing curls. I go to failure. It's my 10th rep. That's the last possible one I can perform. So now I'm going to go for an 11th rep, and I'm trying to get it up, and I can only get it up like 4 inches, and I'm struggling. And what Justin does is he applies just enough help.
Mm-hmm.
To let me get the bar up, but with a lot of struggle. That's why it's called a forced rep. So I'm. It's not like he's helping me a lot, so the rep is easy. He's helping me a little bit, so that the bar barely moves up as I curl it. This will fry the fuck out of your body. It causes a lot of muscle damage.
Lots of damage. Yeah.
It's a technique you can utilize super, super rarely, to the point where I recommend it for almost nobody unless you're super advanced and you've got great recovery ability and everything else is factored in. And every maybe once every macro cycle, like once every 3 to 6 months or so would I throw something like this in. That's how intense it is on the body. So if I'm going to compare a forced rep to not going to failure or doing it on your own, the one that I'm going to say is far more effective is the one that you do on your own, because as we've talked about many times on the show, intensity is important, but it can be overdone very easily. And for the most part, every time you work out, you shouldn't even go to failure. For the most part, if you stop one or two reps short of failure, you're going to see yourself progress right away.
Well, this was such a game-changing mentality for me to begin with, just not having a spotter. Back in the day, it was like if you worked out, especially in the gym, and you're doing these group workouts with the team, or I just thought you always had to have a spotter because you always had to go for that maximal exertion, and to have them around to make sure everything's safe and the weight's not crushing you, all that kind of stuff. Whereas I can't even remember the last time I had like a spotter, and even then I get irritated because like I've had somebody actually spot me on a squat, and I'm like, get the fuck out of here.
Spotting a squat's funny though.
It's just
kind of hug them.
Yeah, it's funny, but it's like, it's unnecessary. I'd rather just dump it,
right?
You know, off my back. And I'm under control enough to be able to do that like more effectively.
As you should.
And I feel like the spotter, it's like awkward. It's like they don't know where exactly to like apply force to help you in the right spot, or like I've never had success with that.
I'm gonna go even further and say that it's such a waste of time. And I know there's a bunch of people that are like,
safety first.
Because we did preface this with saying that, yes, there, you know, when you do a force rep, there's all kinds of muscle damage that happens, which if that happens, it then in turn can build some more muscle. The problem is, and I think why I'm so passionate about it, because just like Justin, I was a kid like this, that when I was 17 to probably 23-ish, I always had a workout partner. And from the very first exercise I did, we were going to failure set one.
Mm-hmm.
Set one, got on the dumbbell press. Like, you had a warm-up set, right, to get the blood flowing. But then we were right to weights where I needed help on my elbows.
You know what I'm thinking right now is just how far we got in spite of the shit training we did. And It was all because we were young and full of testosterone.
Just resilient.
Because if I did that now, I would die.
Yeah.
Back then, I got away with it. I didn't progress like I could have. But the reason why we did is because you're 18 years old. You got all this testosterone flowing. So you just kind of get away with it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
And, you know, I think that it's completely overused by especially, you know, teenage boys in early 20s, because it is this whole motivation, beast mode, no days off is so over glorified that everybody has this mentality. And I still see it even beyond that. So I've got buddies. I just saw a buddy post this morning, you know, and he's like, oh, day one back in the gym, man, my buddy's fucking crushed me, man. I feel great, you know, like, and I'm thinking to myself, like, day one back in the gym, like if there's ever a time that you don't want to crush yourself, it's that day. It's day one in the gym. Like, okay,
recovered from my surgery, hammered my leg.
Yeah. Right. Right. It's like, there is no reason to push PR to that point at that point in your programming, because your body has now got adapted to you not working out. And so any sort of working out is going to send a new signal, a stimulus to it to make it want to grow and build muscle. So I don't want to hammer myself, because that's only going to impede my workout the next day or two. So this is completely overused and abused by so many people. Yeah. Is there a place for it? Yes. If you ever see me use it, I might use it a little more frequently than what Sal recommended, although I agree with him that this is something that is very, very intermittently used throughout your training protocol. I typically use it as the last exercise, the last set, the last exercise of the day. If I'm going to do it, if I'm going to take my to complete failure or ask for a spot, this is it. I did this. I already did two or three different exercises for my chest or shoulders or arms or whatever it is that I'm about to take to failure. And it's the last set, the last exercise, and I'm going to try and force a rep out, and then it's done. It's like I've pushed all the way to that limit. Starting a workout like that is so absurd, and it was something I did for many years. And looking back now, it's one of the dumbest things I ever did, which was right away, I would go right to my favorite exercise for that muscle group, right? So if it's, you know, I'm working chest, it's either flat bench or dumbbell, you know, bench press were my two favorite movements. And you better believe I was lifting the heaviest weight I possibly could on that exercise and taking it to failure or having somebody spot me. And then all the rest of my chest exercises that I would do in that workout were really minimal what they were doing for me because I was already my central nervous system's already fried, my muscles already fatigued. Yeah. So it's just pumping more blood in there. I'm just reinforcing the whole hypertrophy phase of programming. And so I lived in that phase forever because I thought that I needed to go to failure at every set, every exercise I did to get this maximal growth because of the articles like you read in Flex Magazine. I was reading the same bullshit. So yeah, it's grossly overused. I don't recommend spotters, you know, and also I think it's, again, we're talking about the general population. You're now talking about something completely different when you talk about somebody who's a power lifter,
yeah,
who's lifting for a competition, right?
Yeah, you need somebody there, right? A coach.
If there's anybody who uses this technique more than anybody else, it would be these guys, right? But even then, they got to be even more careful.
Even then, they're super calculated about it. Yes. And power lifters rarely go to failure. That's the truth. They rarely ever do.
Exactly.
In fact, there's some powerlifting coaches that say the only time you go to failure is your meet. That's the only time you test yourself with your absolute max. Yeah. Olympic lifters never go to failure except for the day of their competition where they push themselves. Bodybuilders are the ones that use it the most. And a lot of it has to do with, I think, the drugs that they use and the fact that they've got these crazy genetics.
Well, and it goes back to the hypertrophy thing that I was saying. Is sure, if you're all hypertrophy and that's all you train and strength is not as much of a priority, and you can see it. I'm watching our boy Jeremy Buendia doing his deadlifting, and the dude is a fucking, his muscle size and density is, he's this huge, his legs are big. I mean, the guy is 200 something pounds and he's only 5 foot fucking eight or seven or something. I mean, he's, for a little men's physique guy, he's massive. But then, like, you know, deadlifting three plates is a big deal for him. You know, I saw him, he hit a PR the other day at 500 pounds, which, for as big as he is, he should be a lot stronger than that. And as for as much gear that he's probably taken, he should be much stronger than that also. But when you don't train that way, you don't train those movements, and that's what happens. And you can look that impressive because you've trained hypertrophy all the time, but then your muscles don't have the ability to pull up something like that.
Next question is from Ryan C. Jung. In episode 610, you spoke with Dr. Andy Galpin about how Orange Theory took an old, proven wrong concept of optimal training in the heart rate zone and built a business around it. As a PT, I'm being taught to work clients to this zone. Can you please explain how Orange Theory has implemented this concept?
So the heart rate zone theory that we were taught when we were trainers goes like this. If you train within this particular heart rate zone, you will burn more body fat than if you train outside of this zone. If you go too hard, you'll burn less body fat. If you go too low, you burn less body fat. So stay within this, what we used to call the fat burning zone. Now, I didn't realize, but they were taking some science and turning it into a sales method, because now trainer sounds like they can teach you something about cardio, which is really fucking easy. Cardio is easy. Get on the machine and do your cardio. But oh, no, you want me to teach you how to get in the fat burning zone because you don't want to waste your time on this, not burning any body fat.
And you better believe that we use that angle for sure.
We did. Yeah. The reality is what the studies showed was that a greater percentage of your calories came from body fat if you trained within a certain zone. However, the total calories are really what matters most. And if you're just looking at cardio in that particular sense. Now, we've talked about cardio ad nauseum in this show and how it sends the wrong signal if you do too much of it. But if you're just looking at, you know, doing cardio, what's going to burn the most fat, total calories is probably what you really want to look at. Now, as far as Orange Theory is concerned,
they attach themselves more to EPOC than they attach themselves to target heart
rate. I think the reason why Orange Theory used it is it's a way for people to adjust their own intensity in the class when you have one instructor and you have, you know, 15 or 20 people. Because now they can look up at the board, see what their heart rate is, and they can go harder or lower and judge it off of their own individual heart rate. So it's actually brilliant.
Oh, yeah, turn a game out of it.
Yeah, it's actually brilliant in that particular sense. Is it more effective? No, it's a total myth. It doesn't matter. Perceived exertion's more important, really, than any of that. But it is a coaching tool that Orange Theory uses because you know, Orange Theory is a large, it's a business, and they're going to use a lot of gimmicks to, you know, just like the orange light and the branding and whatever, to, you know, attract more people. That being said, I mean, you know, we've talked about Orange Theory in the past, and it's exploding. I definitely see in the future it's going to drop considerably because they're pretty limited. Like, I could see that shit getting boring over and over again. Well, and that type of training is not ideal anyway.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see. What they did really well is they latched onto the culture thing that CrossFit did really good, and they're doing that really well, and that's where they're kind of kicking ass right now. The old proven wrong concept, though, that Orange Theory adopted, I think it was me who referred to that. I wasn't referring to the target heart rate, although the target heart rate zone is a bunch of bullshit, too. I was referring to EPOC. So which is the orange zone. The orange zone in the Orange Theory is pushing you beyond the target heart rate zone. And their theory is that if you spend 12 to 15 minutes in the, you know, in your maximal heart rate zone, which would be the orange zone from Orange Theory, then you are getting the benefits of what's called EPOC. EPOC is excess post oxygen consumption, which is just a fancy acronym to tell us that, okay, because I pushed my body this hard, I'm going to burn X amount more calories per day. The numbers that they use are incredibly inflated, and there's such a huge individual variance in every person from their current metabolism, their size, exactly how hard they pushed, what they ate right before they came in, where they fasted from the day before. There's so many variables that come into play to make that science true or not true that it's pretty much moot. So the fact that they've completely built a brand around a concept that is kind of dead. Like, EPOC is not, we've known about EPOC for a very long time. Mm-hmm. It's just not worth talking about it because it's not that big of a difference. You're talking about this now, studies have come to show that it's probably really the difference of 40 to 50 calories in a day. Like, the difference of you spending 15 minutes in
it's
that.
It's like heating up your core temperature, and then like you stay like somewhat like hot, like leaving the gym. And so now I'm like burning a little bit more calories.
That's really what
internally.
It is. If you push the heart rate up beyond target heart rate, you're obviously, because you're pushing the heart harder, you're obviously going to force more blood, more oxygen, more calories get burned and consumed. So there's your extra calories right there. If you pushed really hard, then it's going to take the body that much longer to let the heart rate come all the way back down, which then in turn burns a few more calories also. And the idea is that all day long, your body is at, your heart rate's at a little bit higher heart rate than what it would normally be if you were like rested all day.
Nothing is going to get you to burn more calories than it's speeding up your metabolism yourself. This whole concept of manual calorie burning, you know, I want to hammer it because it's a terrible approach towards, you know, especially in modern life, to getting lean. If I'm constantly focusing on how many calories I can burn manually by moving, it's a losing battle because my body adapts to that. We have lots of sciences to show that when you just move a lot, do lots of cardio, the body then adapts by becoming more efficient. Some of the ways it becomes more efficient is by reducing your muscle mass. Other ways are by changing hormones, by reducing movement outside of your scheduled movement, by changing your appetite to offset it. You know, there's all these other things that happen. So you may burn extra calories in the short term, but then as your body adapts to it and becomes more efficient, now you're burning roughly as much as you were before, but now you have to exercise your shit ton just to be the same.
Right.
We know, we have studies done on modern hunter-gatherers that prove this. These are societies where people move way more than the average, you know, American, and their calorie burn is not that much more, and it's because their bodies became efficient. Now, if you really want to burn more calories, you send a signal to your body that tells it to become less efficient with its calories. And the best way to do this is by building muscle, building strength and building muscle. And Orange Theory is not a great way to do that. It just isn't. It's circuit type training. You're going to build endurance with it. It's a little bit better than steady state cardio, but it's not, it's nowhere near what, you know, strength training.
I'll tell you why it's really bad, because it's not even really good circuit training, because they did such a good job of building the culture around the Orange Theory and pushing EPOC. And it's the reason why I'm speaking out on it so much, is that it turned this whole, these clubs into this culture of people chasing points.
I mean, because they did such a good job of gamifying it. Now it's become competitive on who can be up in the orange for more time, when in reality, they shouldn't be in there more than 12 to 20 minutes, because that's what the so protocol...
Stretching beyond their actual limitations they had set.
Well, not only that, but then you have these people that are chasing the aerobic side so much, they're not getting the anaerobic benefits, because the way the class is designed is half the class you're spent on the rower and the treadmill, the other half of the class you're spent lifting weights in the weight area. But to get the real good benefits of the weight training, you need to slow.
Be in the orange zone.
You need to slow down. You need to take rest between reps. So when I was there, I used to do that. I used to make my.
I don't know how long how you lasted so long, because you. I remember you saying you would say the opposite of what they would. You ran the classes the way you wanted.
Well, that's why they were so okay with me leaving, right? I kind of ran my own. And shout out to Brendan, because we're buddies and stuff like that, and he. Allowed,
great guy.
Yeah,
love him.
He gave me the flexibility to do that. I think he trusted me to know I was never bad mouthing Orange Theory while I was there. I was doing what I could do to help those people, which would be, I saw these issues. One of those issues being that these people were chasing these points so much that they weren't getting the real benefits of the weight room area. And so when they were in my class, I'd be yelling at everybody, slow the fuck down. If you can keep going from exercise to exercise to exercise without ever stopping, the weight's not heavy enough and you're not giving yourself any rest. It should be a heavy enough weight that the next time you go to pick it up, if you go to pick it up right afterwards with no rest, you won't be able to complete the reps. You'll have to rest to be able to complete the reps. Otherwise, we're just staying aerobic. Otherwise, you may as well just stay on the goddamn treadmill and the rower, because we're doing the same thing and you're just doing it with weights. Mm-hmm. We're not really sending a signal to build a lot of muscle by doing that.
And this is, we did a lot of seminars at some of the local, Orange Theories, and at some point it wasn't conducive for them to even let us speak there, because people would ask us, hey, and these obvious, HPA axis dysfunction or overwork, women would come up to me like,
right.
I'm really fatigued, but I'm taking 4 classes a week and, my diet's 1500 calories. I'm not losing weight. And, my advice would be like, okay, so what you need to do is take 1 class a week and then lift weights at the gym 3 days a week. So I'm telling them to do less Orange Theory and, which I had to.
Weight training.
I'm going to tell them the truth or, what I think is best for them, but. It's not conducive for them to have us speak and then tell the people to do less classes.
People were so I started the thing too within the one that I was at, where I told people, because people would start asking me, and I'm not gonna lie to them, and they'd be like, Adam, this hurts, this is going on this. I'm like, stop running on the treadmill.
Yeah.
And they're like, well, what do I do? That's part of the class. I'm like, walk then. If you're gonna get on it and you're gonna do this part of the class, walk. Walk or spend time doing these corrective movements that I would give them. So you come by my class and there'd be the all treadmill would be walking on the treadmills because
super intense.
And they're like, well, I want to burn more calories. I said, listen, if you want to burn more calories and we want to work on these issues you have, you're sending competing signals. So, maybe walk and hold on to 10-pound dumbbells and retract your shoulders and do basically farmer walks on the treadmill.
Yeah.
So I had these people in my whole class and everyone would be holding these little dumbbells and then be like, what the fuck is going on?
And kudos to you, because you had to get really fucking creative.
Exactly.
So how can I work within these parameters?
Right.
Oh, man.
And, deliver, what the.
If I was started mobility sessions in there and everything.
At the end, right, what you're supposed to do in those classes, I don't know what the protocol is now. When I was there, you're supposed to go through this spiel. And you're supposed to go over all the announcements and whatever is going on with Orange Theory and do all this stuff. I would coach and teach. And so I would teach mobility moves. I would teach 90-90. I would teach these moves. And then while I was teaching them and they were doing the moves, because I only had 7 minutes, it was 7 minutes. What could I give these people that's going to benefit them if they're doing these circuit type classes? So I'd have them doing mobility drills while I'm teaching on the board. I'd be writing nutritional facts. I'd pick one topic of the day and I'd give them these random facts. Luckily, I had Brendan as an owner who I think owns 15 of the facilities now, because if I was in a corporate office, there's no way they would have allowed everything that I did there.
Yeah.
He allowed me my flexibility to help the people. And it showed my classes were, obviously more full than anybody else's. And I have no idea what it's doing now over there, but I heard they've gotten really corporate-like. Mm. And I was a part of a little bit of the Wild Wild West.
Fitness has to be the most fad-driven industry that you could possibly think of.
Oh, my God.
Every decade seems to
drives
have its,
me crazy.
It seems to have its, it's like this curves and then Orange Theory and then, the next wave of whatever. And
a book talks about this is
spinning
is hit makers.
So Hitmakers talks about, and this plays, you talk about fitness being fads, music, movies, everything that we do, it has to have some sort of resemblance of something we've seen before for us to catch on to it and attach ourselves to it. If it's so foreign and so different than anything that we're used to, we're afraid of it. Mm-hmm. But if there is reminiscences of other things that we've seen in the past, then that's something that we will gravitate towards. And so they talk about that's part of the formula in Hitmakers on, you know, how something goes viral, how something takes off, like Orange Theory. Mm-hmm. It's got to have this kind of similar flavor. It's not really, it's like curves and CrossFit, like wrapped in a pretty fucking orange bow is what it is. You know what I'm saying? It's like this combination of the two of them. It's really not that different than those two models.
It's just CrossFit and curves had sex.
Yeah, if CrossFit, they would have an orange baby.
Orange baby.
That's horrible. Check it out.
Smells like citrus.
Go to YouTube. Subscribe to our YouTube channel. There's a new video posted every single day. Justin did something extremely embarrassing on today's video.
Get yourself a bear fight.
You pantsed me.
Check it out. Also, if you go to mindpumpmedia.com, we have 30 days of fitness information. We call it 30 days of coaching. It's free. It's for anybody. Just go there and register. Mindpumpmedia.com.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic, 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.